Hi everyone, in this video I will be talking about seed imaging. I'm Professor David Rousseau, working at University of Angers. Seed imaging, like plant imaging, has undergone a burst of activity in the mid 2000s. And in our place, in our institute in Angers, we started also studying this topic of imaging the seeds at that period, and started to develop our own platform, the phenotypic platform, at the end of the years 2000, and developed many different type of imaging system. The first system was something only dedicated to seed inhibition. And now we can monitor many other traits of seeds and seedling, so the early stage of plant development. So this video is about this variety of techniques. So we are somehow now at the in the same situation as in the biomedical domain, where you have a variety of techniques to monitor human health. And for seed imaging, maybe now at the moment there is a variety of techniques, but it's not clear exactly of which technique you would like to use for which question. While in the biomedical domain, somehow it's rather well known that to have a look at soft tissues in the brain, MRI will be well adapted. While if you want to have a look at what's happening in soft tissue in the in the embryo, maybe ultrasound are more adapted, or if you want to have a look when bones are broken, X-ray are adapted. So which technique is adapted to which question, but in the biomedical domain is well known, but this kind of applicability, interest for the seed imaging is something which is somehow rather new. So how to present all these techniques, making a classification is always something a little bit tricky. So for this video, I decided to follow Dumilly, I would say, the spectrum of application, moving from the small range of wavelength to much larger wavelength, and illustrating for each technique, for each domain of wavelength, the techniques and the kind of biological question you can answer with these imagings. So we start with X-ray imaging, which is widely used for seeds. Basically, the contrast is given by this kind of relationship where you have an absorption by the X-ray, which is related to the intensity of the X-ray that you send on the tissue, multiplied by this exponential, which depends either on the absorption of the material and on the width of these materials. So this will give you a very high contrast when you are looking at dry seed, so seed before imbibition, because you have a very strong contrast in the mu here between air and tissue, which are more or less water. So you will see here on a dry seed that it's very easy to see the contrast between the air part, which is here visible in black in this seed of sugar beet, and the rest of the tissue. Also, this can be used to analyze defaults that you can have in seeds, just like cotyledon spacing or presence of insects which have bitten a bit the a part of the seed. Or also, seeds are prepared mechanically to boost the imbibition, so they are somehow processed before imbibition. And you can have a look at what are the consequences, for instance, on the embryo or on the starch for of these mechanical stresses that are there to help imbibition, so that water will go a little bit faster during imbibition. Here we can see also the seed in the soil, but we will have an issue doing this if we put some water, because then when we have water everywhere, then the contrast will drop dramatically, because there we have water everywhere, so there's only one new and you don't have any contrast between the different parts of the seed. So when tissue gets wet, this is illustrated here, so we look at water coming into a seed of sugar beet, and you can see that there was a strong contrast at the beginning of the imbibition, but something like 6 hours after the beginning of the imbibition, the contrast disappears, and then you cannot see anymore the presence of the embryo or whatever. You still have a strong contrast between the sound and the seed, because the sound doesn't have the same numerical atomic number as the seed, so this contrast stays very, very strong, but the contrast inside the seed drops and you cannot see anymore anything in the seed. So is there any tricks to overcome this limitation of the X-ray? The answer is yes, a very nice work by Yannick Stedler and his group on using some contrasting dyes or liquids that will enable to boost the contrast in mu in the tissue if these contrasting agents are not fixed in the same way or with the same dynamic when they come into the tissue. So this kind of trick is very, very well known in biomedical domain, where you will inject some contrast agents or dyes to boost the contrast, to enhance the contrast. However, it might be invasive somehow, and so you have to control how much these contrast agents would somehow change the biology in a dramatic way. So far, application of such techniques for humans are well controlled, but for plants, the dose that is used is maybe not has not been proven as non-invasive to the plant. So here we have an illustration of the use of a contrast agent on the maize here with polytungstate, which has been imbibed in contact with the maize here for a few minutes. So you can see here on the left that the contrast is very low, while after putting this here in this polytungstate sodium liquid, you really see all the vasculature of the ear pretty well, while it was completely invisible on the left without any contrast agent. Another trick is to look for another source of X-ray, which is a specific source of X-ray only available on limited amount, amount of centers, which are synchrotron radiation facility. In France, we have one in Grenoble and another one close to Paris. ESRF is the one from Grenoble, and Soleil is the one from close to Paris. So this kind of sources of X-ray are different from the classical X-ray because they are like lasers, meaning that there is only one wavelength, one color, somehow, so to say, one only frequency of, on the waves. So same as laser. So because you are losing coherent light, you have access to other contrast than the one which are limited to absorption, but which are also linked to phase difference. So you send a wave onto the object, and if there is a jump of phase, a small delay, then you will be able to have some contrast which is related to these delays. So this kind of delays can occur when you move from one tissue to another where the cellular structure is not the same, which happen in this embryo during the morphogenesis, where the different part, pericarp, nucellus, endosperm, embryo, do not have the same cell organization. And so you will be able to boost the contrast between these different parts of the the cell of the seed, which is nice because with standard X-ray, as you can see, you have very few contrast. So that's the standard method, and that method you can have with after enhancement of the contrast, thanks to the coherent light of the synchrotron radiation facility. Now, if we move to a larger wavelength, you can use fluorescence. Fluorescence is a well-known physical phenomenon where first a photon is absorbed and helps an electron to move from a ground state to a higher state here. It will lose a little bit of energy to go down in a second excitation state, written S1 here, and then go down again to the initial level of energy to emit a fluorescent photon, which will, because we have lost a little bit of energy in the second step, will be at a wavelength which will be larger than the initial wavelengths, because we have less energy, we have lost a little bit of energy. So this can be used to analyze the maturity of the seed, to predict the maturity of the seed, and analysis of the spectrum of the fluorescence on a small population of seed will be doable with this kind of system here. Now, if we move to the visible spectrum, so reflectance imaging, where you basically just send photons and you look at contrast due to difference of reflectance, so it can be used to monitor, for instance, seed inhibition on these systems, or also for monitoring the seedling emergence out of the soil. So here, in the previous slide, we had a contrast on the wet blotter and the seed, which was purposely chosen blue here to be well contrasted to the seed. And here, the contrast in reflectance is between the soil and the seed. We have developed such analysis so far with a deep learning method recently published, and we can monitor individually how much when we move from one state to the other, the different stages of development being the soil, first appearance out of the soil, opening of the cotyledon, first leaf, second leaf, and so on. So when we are dealing with reflectance imaging, it can be interesting to consider the possibility to select different wavelengths among the spectrum. This can include different techniques with various complexity of technological devices. You can have a selection of only one wavelength by using some electronic devices, tunable electronic devices like the one on the right, or more simply or simpler with LEDs specially chosen at a wavelength where you believe you have a strong contrast. Also, you can use color imaging with a Bayer filter specially dedicated to your application. So CCD camera, a basic CCD camera does not have a free wavelength for each pixel. It's a kind of a chess board pattern like this. And each color corresponds to a given filter. So you have basic by default filters proposed by the camera manufacturers. But you can also nowadays request for a specific wavelength if you believe these wavelengths are better for your application. You also have, so this is something like a 10 kilo euro system nowadays. Here you can also have different cameras, like here, but the disadvantage of this is that with different filters on each, in front of each objective of the camera, disadvantage is that all optical axis of these cameras are not aligned. And so somehow you will have to register your images, which is okay if you are doing remote sensing on UAVs or on satellite imaging, but not for proxy detection. Also, you can have a kind of filter wheel, which will move from one filter to another with a single camera. So here you don't have this problematic of having different optical axes, there is only one, but acquisition at the different wavelengths are not done at the same time, so you might have some issue if there is wind or if you are working in non-controlled condition due to movement of the plant. And the highest cost is when you use hyperspectral imaging system, where for each pixel you don't have three, one or six wavelength, but you may have hundreds of wavelength, where for each pixel you have some kind of a spectrometer, you have access to a single spectrometer. So the selection of the wavelength can be based on the biology. For instance, here if you are looking for ceiling elongation, you may want to not be invasive in the way you do this monitoring, and try to send light at the part of the spectrum where you don't see any absorption by the plant. So what we call inactinic light, so green light that you will send on the ceilings during elongation to mimic somehow the condition they have in the soil where there is no light at all. But you can also base the selection of the wavelengths based on the contrast, so as to have the best contrast. So you have a nice illustration here with apple scab, which is almost not visible for the human eye on the left. If you convert it to a gray level image, you have of course also no contrast. But if you select smartly the wavelength that is giving you the best contrast, then you have something which is much better than what you have at the RGB image with a single channel image. So you can do this selection physically with putting the right filter, or you can acquire, like on the right part, different wavelength with a hyperspectral camera and then reduce the dimension, but you will get similar result to what you have if you optimize the filter at the level of the sensor. Sometimes you might not have to select a wavelength, but the whole spectrum is indeed necessary. So that's the case in this application to predict seed aging here. So in the previous case, application to the seed was to discrimination between radical and hypocotyle with a single snapshot, or difference of seed between hard and soft weed. Here, the application is to predict seed aging, and you can see that the difference of spectrum between non-edge and edge seeds is very tiny, so that there is no interest in selecting only one wavelength, but it's interesting to integrate on a larger part of the spectrum, here located between 500 and 700 nanometers. You can see again that with your human eye, it's not possible to see the difference, but for the camera, it's possible to detect the presence of the aging effect of the aging on the viability of the seed. Again, in the visible spectrum domain, it's possible to resort to the use of coherent line, meaning laser, where you will have a higher sensitivity to tiny modifications. So for instance, if you're looking for seed viability or seed imbibition, you will see a very tiny displacement of the seed due to the use of a laser, and you will have the visibility of a viable seed and a non-viable seed after only 1 or 2 hours, while in the usual approach it's something like 48 hours you have to wait for to do a difference between 2 seeds, one being viable and not non-viable. Thermal imaging can also be used, so we are now in the infrared domain, and thermal imaging between 3 micron and 5 micron, or 8 micron to 12 microns, that can operate completely in the dark, so it can be useful if you want to look for seed elongation without any light, or if you want to look for seed imbibition, so process that would occur in the soil. And you can operate completely in full darkness. And also it gives access to information like difference between radicle and hypocotyl, because this imaging will provide you with an information of difference of temperature, and there will be a difference of temperature between the radicle and the hypocotyl due to the fact that water will come into the seed via the absorbing cells, which are located on the radicle of the seed, so causing a lower temperature on the seedling. Also, infrared can be used for LIDAR. So this is something that we have published here on using cameras that gives directly the distance from seedlings to the camera, and you can monitor with a very high frame rate information on how plants are growing during day and night here. And again, many more applications that you can find. Near-infrared spectroscopy can be used, also terahertz in imaging. MRI can be used also to have access to quantification of the lipid in the embryo, near-infrared spectroscopy to qualify the maturity of the seeds, or terahertz to detect about the presence of disease in the seed, or the amount of water in the seed. So now, if we come to a kind of proposal of what can be used for what, maybe we can classify functional imaging and anatomical imaging. So X-ray can be used for anatomical, also visible and hyperspectral, depth, so LIDAR for anatomical again, and terahertz also. And for functional, you will find these imaging system, as we explained earlier. Which tool for which question? So here, if you want to do morphogenesis, X-ray can be used. Dry seed, you can use X-ray. Fluorescence, visible hyperspectral. Imbibition, you will use X-ray, laser, and thermal imaging. Elongation, you can use X-ray, visible spectral imaging and thermal imaging. And also for the seedling monitoring, you can use fluorescence, visible, and depth, as we presented before. So the take-home message of this presentation, that seed imaging technology is mature. The bottleneck is now on image and data processing, and we may wonder if artificial intelligence can solve all this. Indeed, there has been a kind of revolution with the boom of deep learning appeared in 2012, where when you develop an image processing algorithm, you do not have to fix the parameter by yourself, because the machine will somehow replace the image processing expert by selecting the best parameters of your algorithm. These are economical consequences on this, because in the past, somehow it took 1 year to design an algorithm, while now it will take you somehow a couple of days only to have an efficient algorithm. providing you have some annotated data set. So, of course, to have this data set, you need to have someone who annotated this, which becomes actually the bottleneck for the design of algorithms. So in our group, in order to avoid annotating too much data set, what we do is we use synthetic data to boost the learning of the algorithm, like we did here on seeds, on roots, or on cells in vitro imaging. Here are some references of our group which have been working on this topic for something like more than 10 years. And I thank you for your attention, and also I acknowledge all the collaborators who have been contributing to this work. Thank you for your attention.